I'm here to talk about acne vulgaris and update in management. It's a great time to talk about updates in the care and management of acne because there were some new clinical guidelines just recently published in the Journal of American Academy of Dermatology in 2024. Hi, I'm Dr. Sheilagh Maguiness, and I am a board-certified pediatric dermatologist. I'm also professor of dermatology and pediatrics at the University of Minnesota. In the recent guidelines, we really take an overview about using multimodal therapy and avoiding using things like systemic or topical antibiotics as monotherapy in the treatment of acne. And that's because using antibiotics as monotherapy can lead to things like antimicrobial resistance. So the idea of using multimodal therapy with multiple agents that have different mechanisms of action is a great update when it comes to thinking about your plan for your patients with acne. Another potential pitfall in the primary care setting is that clinical studies have shown that there seems to be an underuse of topical retinoids amongst primary care doctors as one of the first line agents for acne vulgaris. And truly, tretinoin is one of our mainstay first line treatments, and it's great to get comfortable knowing how to use it. One thing that's helpful to frame is that acne is actually categorized based on the age it presents. So first, if we want to talk about baby acne, this is an interesting one because baby acne is actually not true acne. And that's because when you look at these babies showing up, you know, between 2 and 3 weeks of age with the little papules and pustules on their face and head and neck, you don't see true comedones. So there's no blackheads, there's no true whiteheads. So it's not really acne per se, but rather baby acne, also known as cephalic pustulosis, is a reaction to the overgrowth of a yeast species on the skin. Infantile acne is another thing that you might see in practice, and there it is more likely to be true acne. You might actually see comedones and blackheads and whiteheads, inflammatory pustules, and even cysts. And that typically shows up in young infants between 6 months and about a year. That type of acne needs to be treated just like regular adolescent acne and is also posing a risk for scarring if it's severe or inflammatory. Mid-childhood is a time when children should not have acne. That is a time where if you see a child aged 1 to 7 in your clinical practice and they have comedones or cysts or true acne, you need to dig deeper because that could mean that there are some endocrine abnormalities in that child, like early puberty, that are driving those changes. Then, of course, we have adolescent acne vulgaris. It's so common. 85% of all teens are affected by acne. And I think it's really important for primary care doctors, especially pediatricians, to really take the time to ask about acne because the severity of the acne does not necessarily correlate with its impact on adolescent mental health. And it has higher association with things like anxiety, depression, and even suicidal ideation. So taking the time to address it with your patients will go a really long way. Another thing to consider is the severity of the acne. If it's very inflammatory, if you see cysts or early scarring, that's a sign that maybe you need to refer for help. Interacting with your teen and adolescent patients can be tons of fun. Of course, there are some pitfalls like we've talked about, but this is a really exciting time of establishing great hygiene, maybe building a basic acne regimen, and don't forget, there's help out there if you need it. So the American Academy of Pediatrics has a lot of resources on their healthychildren.org website about acne. And as well, your colleagues in pediatric dermatology have a lot of resources. Check out their website on the Society for Pediatric Dermatology homepage, which is www.pedsderm.net.